Hello and welcome to the Peppermint Sunflower channel, where we pair video of the beautiful natural world with calming narration of classic literature. Following the treacherous betrayal we discovered last time, this week we learn how the Tremolino meets her demise. And now, over to Joseph Conrad. It was settled. I had now the courage to turn about. Our men crouched about the decks here and there with anxious, crestfallen faces, all turned one way to watch the chaser. For the first time that morning, I perceived César stretched out full length on the deck near the foremast and wondered where he had been skulking till then. But he might in truth have been at my elbow all the time, for all I knew. We had been too absorbed in watching our fate to pay attention to each other. Nobody had eaten anything that morning, but the men had been coming constantly to drink at the water butt. I ran down to the cabin. I had there put away in a locker 10,000 francs in gold, of whose presence on board, so far as I was aware, not a soul except Dominic had the slightest inkling. When I emerged on deck again, Dominic had turned about and was peering from under his cowl at the coast. Cape Creux closed the view ahead. To the left, a wide bay, its waters torn and swept by fierce squalls, seemed full of smoke. Astern, the sky had a menacing look. Directly he saw me, Dominic, in a placid tone, wanted to know what was the matter. I came close to him, and looking as unconcerned as I could, told him in an undertone that I had found the locker broken open and the money belt gone. Last evening it was still there.
"What did you want to do with it?"
he asked me, trembling violently. "Put it around my waist, of course," I answered, amazed to hear his teeth chattering.
"Cursed gold," he muttered.
"The weight of the money might have cost you your life, perhaps," he shuddered. "There is no time to talk about that now. I am ready."
"Not yet.
I am waiting for that squall to come over," he muttered, and a few leaden minutes passed. The squall came over at last. Our pursuer, overtaken by a sort of murky whirlwind, disappeared from our sight. The Tremolino quivered and bounded forward. The land ahead vanished too, and we seemed to be left alone in a world of water and wind.
"Prenez le bois, monsieur,"
Dominic broke the silence suddenly in an austere voice.
"Take hold of the tiller."
He bent his hood to my ear.
"The balancelle is yours. Your own hands must deal the blow. I have yet another piece of work to do."
He spoke up loudly to the man who steered.
"Let the signorino take the tiller, and you with the others stand by to haul the boat alongside quickly at the word."
The man obeyed, surprised but silent. The others stirred and pricked up their ears at this. I heard their murmurs.
"What now?
Are we going to run in somewhere and take to our heels? The padrone knows what he's doing." Dominic went forward. He paused to look down at César, who, as I have said before, was lying full length face down by the foremast, then stepped over him and dived out of my sight under the foresail. I saw nothing ahead. It was impossible for me to see anything except the foresail open and still, like a great shadowy wing. But Dominic had his bearings. His voice came to me from forward in a just audible cry.
"Now, signorino!"
I bore on the tiller as instructed before. Again I heard him faintly, and then I only had to hold her straight. No ship ran so joyously to her death before. She rose and fell as if floating in space, and darted forward, whizzing like an arrow. Dominic, stooping under the foot of the foresail, reappeared and stood steadying himself against the mast, with a raised forefinger in an attitude of expectant attention. A second before the shock, his arm fell down by his side. At that, I set my teeth. And then, talk of splintered planks and smashed timbers, this shipwreck lies upon my soul with the dread and horror of a homicide, with the unforgettable remorse of having crushed a living, faithful heart at a single blow. At one moment, the rush and the soaring swing of speed, the next, a crash and death, stillness. A moment of horrible immobility, with the song of the wind changed to a strident wail, and the heavy waters boiling up, menacing and sluggish,
around the corpse. I saw in a distracting minute the foreyard fly fore and aft with a brutal swing, the men all in a heap cursing with fear and hauling frantically at the line of the boat. With a strange welcoming of the familiar, I saw also César amongst them and recognised Dominic's old, well-known effective gesture, the horizontal sweep of his powerful arm. I recollect distinctly saying to myself, César must go down, of course. And then, as I was scrambling on all fours, the swinging tiller I had let go caught me a crack under the ear and knocked me over senseless. I don't think I was actually unconscious for more than a few minutes, but when I came to myself, the dinghy was driving before the wind into a sheltered cove, two men just keeping her straight with their oars. Dominic, with his arm around my shoulders, supported me in the stern sheets. We landed in a familiar part of the country. Dominic took one of the boat's oars with him. I suppose he was thinking of the stream we would have presently to cross, on which there was a miserable specimen of a punt, often robbed of its pole. But first of all, we had to ascend the ridge of land at the back of the cape. He helped me up. I was dizzy. My head felt very large and heavy. At the top of the ascent, I clung to him and we stopped to rest. To the right, below us, the wide, smoky bay was empty. Dominic had kept his word. There was not a chip to be seen around the black rock from which the Tremolino, with her plucky heart crushed at one blow, had slipped off into deep water to her eternal rest. The vastness of the open sea was smothered in driving mists, and in the centre of the thinning squall, phantom-like, under a frightful press of canvas, the unconscious Garda Costa dashed on, still chasing to the northward. Our men were already descending the reverse slope to look for that punt, which we knew from experience was not always to be found easily. I looked after them with dazed, misty eyes. 1, 2, 3, 4. Dominic, where's César? I cried. As if repulsing the very sound of the name, the padrone made that ample, sweeping, knockdown gesture. I stepped back a pace and stared at him fearfully. His open shirt uncovered his muscular neck and the thick hair on his chest. He planted the oar upright in the soft soil and, rolling up his right sleeve, extended the bare arm before my face. This, he began with an extreme deliberation whose superhuman restraint vibrated with the suppressed violence of his feelings, is the arm which delivered the blow. I am afraid it is your own gold that did the rest. I forgot all about your money. He clasped his hands together in sudden distress. I forgot, he repeated disconsolately. César stole the belt? I stammered out, bewildered. And who else? Canalia. He must have been spying on you for days. And he did the whole thing, absent all day in Barcelona. Traditore. Sold his jacket to hire a horse. Ha ha, a good affair. I tell you it was he who set him at us. Dominic pointed at the sea, where the Garda Costa was a mere dark speck. He dropped his chin on his breast. On information, he murmured in a gloomy voice. Ah, Sevoni, oh, my poor brother. And you drowned him? I said feebly. I struck once and the wretch went down like a stone with the gold. Yes, but he had time to read in my eyes that nothing could save him while I was alive. And had I not the right, I, Dominic Sevoni, padrone, who had brought him aboard your felucca, my nephew, a traitor? He pulled the oar out of the ground and helped me carefully down the slope. All the time, he never once looked me in the face. He punted us over, then shouldered the oar again and waited till our men were at some distance before he offered me his arm. After we had gone a little way, the fishing hamlet we were making for came into view. Dominic stopped. Do you think you can make your way as far as the houses by yourself? He asked me quietly. Yes, I think so. But why? Where are you going, Dominic? Anywhere. What a question, Signorino. You are but little more than a boy to ask such a question of a man having this tale in his family. Ah, traditore! What made me ever own that spawn of a hungry devil for our own blood? Thief, cheat, coward, liar! Other men can deal with that, but I was his uncle, and so I wish he had poisoned me, Charogne. But this, that I, a confidential man and a Corsican, should have to ask your pardon for bringing on board your vessel, of which I was padrone, a Savoni, who has betrayed you, a traitor, that is too much. It is too much. Well, I beg your pardon, and you may spit in Dominic's face because a traitor of our blood taints us all. A theft may be made good between men, a lie may be set right, a death avenged. But what can one do to atone for a treachery like this? Nothing. He turned and walked away from me along the bank of the stream, flourishing a vengeful arm and repeating to himself slowly with savage emphasis, "Ah, canaille, canaille, canaille." He left me there, trembling with weakness and mute with awe. Unable to make a sound, I gazed after the strangely desolate figure of that seaman, carrying an oar on his shoulder up a barren, rock-strewn ravine, under the dreary, leaden sky of the Tremolino's last day. Thus, walking deliberately with his back to the sea, Dominic vanished from my sight. With the quality of our desires, thoughts, and wonder proportioned to our infinite littleness, we measured even time itself by our own stature. Imprisoned in the house of personal illusions, 30 centuries in mankind's history seems less to look back upon than 30 years of our own life. And Dominic Savoni takes his place in my memory by the side of the legendary wanderer on the sea of marvels and terrors, by the side of the fatal and impious adventurer to whom the evoked shade of the soothsayer predicted a journey inland with an oar on his shoulder till he met men who had never set eyes on ships and oars. It seems to me I can see them side by side in the twilight of an arid land, the unfortunate possessors of the secret lore of the sea, bearing the emblem of their hard calling on their shoulders, surrounded by silent and curious men. Even as I, too, having turned my back upon the sea, am bearing those few pages in the twilight, with the hope of finding in an inland valley the silent welcome of some patient listener. Thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed both the chapter and the video. If you have any suggestions for classic books you would like to hear read on this channel, please drop a note in the comments below. Episodes are uploaded every Sunday. Please do subscribe to make sure you don't miss them.